We have a bunch of announcements this week here at LinuxCon about a variety of new initiatives that the Linux Foundation is supporting. I'd like to start out by talking about our core infrastructure initiative and a new announcement we have this week relative to that project. How many people here have heard of the core infrastructure initiative? Wow, so quite a few of you. The Core Infrastructure Initiative is something that we started at the Linux Foundation after the Heartbleed bug earlier this year in response to a problem that we were seeing with a variety of projects in open source and all over the world, which was that there were these open source projects that are extremely important and over time had become extremely important to the stability and security of the internet. And for whatever reason, those projects had not received the kind of resources that was commensurate with that particular role that those projects had played in the security and stability of the internet. So what the Linux Foundation did with some of the largest technology companies in the world, the companies you see here, Amazon, Facebook, Google, Intel, and others, was to get together and say, we would like to support these projects. We would like to provide some resources, some fellowships, infrastructure, and other things to help make all of these projects better. This year, we made initial grants to the OpenSSL project, OpenSSH, and NTP. In fact, this week, we are hosting the first in-person meeting of the OpenSSL project, I believe, in the history of that project. So I'd like to welcome the members of the OpenSSL community who are here today to LinuxCon for your first meeting. So welcome. But certainly, the job of working to help projects that are important to the global infrastructure of the internet and to all of the organizations who depend on technology is never done. Just recently, we saw additional vulnerabilities around the Bash project, which, you know, again, had the same characteristics of a project that had become very, very widely deployed, but didn't have the resources commensurate with that that wide deployment. So this week, we are announcing a call for proposals for the Core Infrastructure Initiative. We are asking sites, we are asking projects that meet the characteristics of being very widely deployed but need some help to come to the Linux Foundation. We've got a form online in our website to write up a proposal. We are looking for projects to help. So if you meet these characteristics, we would like you to make it known to us, and hopefully there will be lots of other projects that the Core Infrastructure Initiative can help this year and in years to come. So I look forward to getting those proposals, and we hope we see many, many of them. We have another announcement today about a new project that we are hosting here at the Linux Foundation. I think many of you have seen throughout the year, in addition to the Core Infrastructure Initiative, the Linux Foundation has become home to a variety of large-scale open source projects. Just a few weeks ago, for example, we launched a project called OPNFV. This is an open source reference implementation for network function virtualization, supported by some of the largest operators throughout the world. Vodafone, AT&T, China Mobile, Docomo, etc., who are getting together in an open source project to really change the way that networks are built and are doing that in open source, which is terrific. And it's not just in areas of cloud infrastructure or Linux that we're doing work in, but today we are announcing a new project that we think is pretty cool. And we have a quick video here that will introduce that very project. Let's check it out. Thank you. Let's hear it for drones. I love it. So we thought this would be a terrific forum to introduce this project. How many people here think drones are pretty cool? All right. Non-military use. All right. Just to be super clear. This is a terrific project. You know, with the Embedded Linux conference here this week, we thought this would be a perfect forum to introduce this project. It's a new project that actually has gotten quite a lot of momentum already, but is now sort of graduating to a place where it can be neutrally hosted and shared by a lot of folks throughout the industry. This project is really interesting. Drone code is already being used in a huge variety of applications throughout the industry. In fact, the dronecode.org community already has a vibrant set of developers, over 1,200 developers, committing a lot of code to this project. Drones are only at the very beginning of what I think is going to be an incredible industry with applications that we haven't thought of. And that's what makes it such a great open source project, is the more people who get involved with it, the more we're going to see unexpected innovation in these platforms that are powering such an interesting and vibrant new industry. We're happy to have the support from the industry, who now depends on this code base. Dronecode.org code is already in a ton of commercial products that are out there being used today. You see companies like 3D Robotics, companies like Qualcomm, Intel, Box, Skyward, JDrones, and others all using this code already today and supporting this code base for what's really a new and exciting industry. And we think that they're going to be able to invest even more in this project now that it's at a neutral home where there's professional management that will really enable this community to thrive. So we would like to welcome the Drone Code community. And I actually have a special guest here, Lorenz Meyer, who is from the University of Zurich and leads the PX4 project for Drone Code. So come on up, welcome.
Thank you.
So why don't you come on over here. So I thought I would have, so Lorenz is sort of one of the Linus Torvalds of Drone Code. He is the maintainer of the PX4 project for Drone Code. And there's another maintainer that this crowd has heard of before, who's working on Drone Code. Can you tell us who that person is?
Tridge, Andrew Tridgel.
So Andrew
With APM.
That's right. So Andrew Tridgel, it turns out. Does anybody here know Andrew Tridgel? Does anybody here know Samba? All right, so of course. So it turns out Tridge, in addition to working on Samba, is now working on Drone Code. So tell us a little bit about what Drone Code is and what you guys are doing in the project.
I think Drone Code has currently two main dimensions. One is to integrate the drone community, and because drones are actuators, motor controllers, they're autopilots, and they are embedded. It's a whole stack. And so it brings together various projects on various levels into one place. And the second dimension is it allows, because we want our work, we love developing these drones, but we also want them to be useful. And so it brings together developers in industry so that they can deploy into applications.
And so where is this code already being used?
I mean, the question is, where is it not used? The applications are so wide. They go from search and rescue, kind of niche applications, to everyday flying for a lot of hobbyists, aerial photography, precision agriculture. And I think there are many applications that we haven't really quite seen yet, and that will depend on more autonomy. And this is where we think, in particular, higher level processing on embedded Linux will become really important.
So why did the Linux Foundation get involved here? Why did you guys come to us to help out?
So I think the whole field is in a state where you can buy open source products and you can use them and they're useful. But we noticed that what is missing is kind of a central place for the community to come together to meet in person, like on conferences. And we've seen what the Linux Foundation has done for the Linux conference. And so I think we wanted that too.
Great. Great. Well, we look forward to hosting a lot of those things. But the most important question for this crowd, noting that there are a lot of folks working on embedded Linux development and a bunch of stuff that looks, I think, somewhat similar to what you're working on with drones, how can these folks get involved in the project?
So the whole field is already vibrant and active, and you can go to dronecode.org. You'll find the individual projects linked there, and we are indeed looking for developers. And we have ventured in academia already deeply into embedded Linux and ROS, and so we hope that this will gain a lot more momentum with the community connecting here.
Great, great. Well, thanks for coming. We look forward to working with you on the project.
Thank you.
All right. So how many folks here are going to go check out dronecode.org and get involved? We got nice. I love seeing this. I really think if we can get these communities, the embedded Linux community, together with this drone code community, that we can do some really interesting things. And you know, this kind of, you know, large-scale collaboration, open source projects like this, whether it's drones or whether it's cloud technology, are really redefining the entire tech industry. And I want to spend a little time today talking about just how big of a deal what all of you are doing and what these communities mean to the tech sector. If you look around these days, there are lots and lots of large-scale open source projects, lots and lots of large-scale open source foundations sort of seemingly springing up everywhere, right? In virtually every new sector of tech, we're seeing a new big open source project emerging in leading edge areas of the technology industry. Whether it's in software-defined networking with the Open Daylight project, whether it's in the cloud with OpenStack and CloudStack, whether it's in the Internet of Things with projects like the AllScene Alliance, and now with drones, with DroneCode.org. Literally almost every layer of the technology stack and almost every vertical industry within tech, there seems to be an open source project that's really leading innovation. Not just like following, you know, an already established proprietary implementation, but really leading the technology sector with open source. And the question is, why is that happening? Why is this form of development, and why are these kind of foundations and large open source projects really gaining so much momentum, particularly as of late? And I think one of the reasons for that is best stated by Marc Andreessen, who wrote in an op-ed at the Wall Street Journal, the fact that software is becoming so important to the tech sector. He termed this sort of software is eating the world. And what he meant by that is that the expectations that people have for technology, the way that people are deriving value from technology these days, increasingly is because of software. If you think about almost any area of tech, whether it's mobile devices, you know, if you look at any mobile phone with the power off, they pretty much look all the same, right? It's just a, you know, blank screen. It's just a huge piece of glass, right? And if you turn it on, it's the software that is really defining what that device is capable of and where all of the value comes from. We're seeing wholesale areas that used to be hardware-centric now being abstracted into software. You know, server virtualization, we're now seeing it in the network with software-defined networking and network function virtualization. We're really seeing, again, more and more that software is sort of the area where people are deriving a lot of value from tech. And then just the raw volume of software that needs to be created as a result is going up. And one of the things that I thought was interesting about this statement, that software is eating the world, is an additional comment, in fact, that was in the same paper in the Wall Street Journal that came from a gentleman named Ibrahim Haddad from Samsung. And that is that open source software is eating the software world itself. So it's a kind of a 1-2 combination, the fact that software is now such a dominant part of the tech sector, and in software, open source is really dominating that. And so why is that? Why is open source becoming this dominant way of producing software? Well, I think it's because there's really a new paradigm going on in software development. What I like to describe as a Pareto principle for software development. How many people here know what the Pareto principle is? So this is the 80-20 rule, right? That, you know, 20% of something derives like 80% of the value, and we are starting to see that happen in software. You know, that now that we have so, just in terms of sheer lines of code, so much software to produce, people need to decide where they're going to spend their time and energy and resources relative to that software development itself. What is that 20% that any organization or individual is going to focus on spending their time? And what we're seeing is really a strategic use of open source. Organizations are moving from using, you know, maybe 30, 40% of the code in any of their products and services being open source, towards a world where almost 80% of the code in many products and services today are made up of open source software. I talk to companies all over the world who are telling me, listen, you know, if we look at any of our products and services, whether I'm hosting a cloud, whether I'm making a mobile device, inside of our code bases, really 80% of that code is open source. And the reason that they're moving that way is because A, there's so much code to produce that they would rather work collectively on producing that underlying code. But more importantly, I think the software industry is going to an area where organizations are shedding commodity research and development, they're shedding research and development out into the open where you can innovate faster, and then instead focusing on this 20% which makes their product or service or organization unique. And we really see this specifically in a lot of different companies. Here's one example. Sony tells me 80% of the software in their handsets are open source. That's crazy. If 80% of the code in your products and services are open source, the question is, what are you doing to participate in open source, to manage your organization's participation in open source? And there's a really interesting way to think about this. Now that open source is becoming so important, I think it's interesting to look at how companies are spending time and money on research and development, right? The top 10 tech companies in the world spend about $64 billion a year, $63.4 billion a year on research and development. So it looks something like this, right? Microsoft, IBM, Cisco, Google, Amazon, all of these organizations spend billions of dollars every year on research and development. And I'll just, you know, pick one as an example. Let's pick the number two here. Samsung, $9 billion a year on research and development. And what Samsung says is today, you really can't build a product without open source. So Samsung's spending $9 billion a year on research and development, and they cannot build a product without open source. If 80% of the code in your products or service comes from research and development that's happening outside of your company, and you're spending $9 billion a year on research and development, it begs one very important question. And that question is, how are you managing your external research and development? This, I think, is one of the most important questions that the tech sector and all of your companies and organizations need to answer today. how are we managing external research and development? How do we understand how to participate in open source projects, consume open source projects in our products and services? How do we comply with the intellectual property regime of these open source projects? How do we integrate open source development into our product development cycle? This is one of the most important questions in a multi-billion dollar R&D industry that the tech sector has to ask today. And I want to show you some examples of how companies are actually doing this. These people here are external R&D managers. Chris DiBona from Google, Eileen Evans from HP. You know, all of these people, their entire job, the reason they work at their company is so that they can manage how their particular company participates in, has different developers who work on open source projects. They're in charge of their organization's external research and development. The largest companies, the best technology companies in the world, have dedicated teams who are managing their external research and development, right? And these teams are large, and they have dozens, in some cases, hundreds of individuals who are working on managing their external research and development. Because as we move towards a world where the majority of code in any product comes from open source, all of your organizations, your company, needs to grow a new set of competencies to manage that open source code in those products and services. It's a wholesale set, new set of skills that companies around the world need to develop. To analyze which open source projects are important and which open source projects are not important, right? Is this a project that I want to invest my time in? Is it a project that I should not invest my time in? People need to understand the intellectual property regimes in open source. What does one open source license mean versus another open source license? How do I share what I want to share? How do I keep what I want to keep? In particular, at the Linux Foundation, we're finding that this particular question around intellectual property management is one of the most difficult questions for many organizations to answer. This is the one case where we actually need more lawyers, right? And we need more lawyers who understand open source, right? Because open source isn't just about giving everything away, it's about sharing what you want to share and keeping what you want to keep, right? And if we can help more and more lawyers and business people understand that, we will get more people involved in the development process. And software development itself is changing because of open source. Social coding, things like you see up on GitHub, the form of software development that open source has really pioneered, is now becoming the mainstream of software development. And people who haven't participated in open source projects need to learn how to participate in open source projects. And then lastly, the business process needs to change in companies so that they can effectively use open source in their products. One of the questions I get asked the most about is, when I'm making a new product, how do I bring open source in? How do I make changes to open source code as I'm developing a new product? And then how do I share those changes back with the upstream project during that product development cycle? This is an actual skill that your company needs to understand in order to most effectively leverage open source. And so I think one of the most important questions that you should ask yourself, or you should ask your organization, the company you work for, is, are you ready for the next open source blockbuster? Does your organization have the skills that are needed to participate in this grand collaborative development world that is now defining the software industry and the technology industry at large? And so that's the one question I'd like all of you to think about this week How can you get better at doing this? How can you help your organization get better at managing external research and development, open source development, so that we can get more and more people into the open source community and do even more interesting projects? Again, whether it's drones, embedded Linux, cloud computing, we really want to see more and more people participating in this critically important form of development for the technology industry. So if you're getting ready for the next open source blockbuster, the next question would be, what is an open source blockbuster, right? Does anybody here know what an open source blockbuster should look like? What does like the best, most winning open source project look like? What are the characteristics that you think make a big open source project? Is it things like this? 9 changes of code in an hour. Is that right, Greg? So Greg Crowe Hartman's right here. The Linux kernel is changing about, on average, about 9 times an hour. It represents billions of dollars in research and development. Millions of developers are using this all over the world. It dominates almost every sector of technology that it's in. This really does look like an open source blockbuster, right? And those numbers are important. These are really important numbers in terms of what makes a great open source project. And you should all be ready for the next great open source project. But these numbers are important, but they're not enough. They're not enough to really make an open source blockbuster. What really makes an open source blockbuster, in my opinion, is defined by the following. I want to show you a short video that I think truly defines an open source blockbuster.
We had a family PC since about 2010, and in 2012, I heard of Linux, and I started experimenting with it a lot. I think my first distro was Ubuntu 12.04 that I tried out in VirtualBox. I don't know too much programming. I don't even know much programming, but I would still love to learn programming and even get a job. You know, maybe someday I could probably become a sysadmin in Linux. I could help people use Linux. It was a school project. Of course, I decided to send a letter to Linus Torvalds. He was my hero, and I was actually doubting I would actually be able to find out, you know, who I could send it to. Then I remembered how much I love Linux and, you know, how much I wanted to meet Linus Torvalds, so I decided to send him a letter. You know, all my other friends sent letters to, you know, more Hollywood or internet celebrities, but I doubt they actually got flown to, you know, a good place like this to meet them. Meeting Linus Torvalds was a great experience. Once the whole panel thing was done, he went out of the stage, went into my row, and we shook hands, and he signed my Linux Bible, and he gave me a copy of his Just for Fun book with a signature, of course. I loved meeting Linus Torvalds, and it was a great experience overall. I got to have so much goodies or swag, and it made me think, you know, all these things like my future is going to be great, and you know, I loved it.
So this was at our LinuxCon event in Chicago this summer, and we had a party that evening at the Science Museum in Chicago. It's the biggest science museum in the western half of the United States. And I met Zach. He came up to me and looked me in the eye and said, "I am having the best day of my entire life." That is an open source blockbuster, no doubt. And that is what I think is so important to remember about open source. Open source isn't just a good business strategy. It's more than that. What's great about open source and Linux is that it's both. From what I've already told you today, the business of technology is moving to open source. Open source is now defining the technology industry. And at the same time as open source is so critical to business, it's also providing something more important than business value. It's providing a lesson in sharing. It turns out that Richard Stallman and Linus Torvalds and all of the people involved in open source early, who talked about sharing all the time, were right. That we are on the right side of history with open source. Because what we're doing is something where you can not only better yourself and better your company, but you can better the world. And it is so good to be a part of something that can do all of those things at once. And so whenever you're working on whatever project you're working on, or if you're having a bad day at your company and frustrated that you want to do more and that people don't get open source in your organization, just remember this. What you're doing is important. And what you're doing is bigger than just your company or any individual, but that you're all doing something that really makes the world a better place. And that's really important. Thank you.